I'm going to preach this morning. All right? And I do believe that God's given me a fresh word for this congregation. There's nothing on YouVersion. If you're looking in the app, there's nothing on YouVersion. There's not going to be anything on the screen other than a text this morning and a title. What I want you to do is listen. Just listen to what I've got to say to you this morning, because I believe that God's going to speak deeply into your heart. I believe God's going to do something in your life today. How many of you would just simply say that you have had one hell of a year and it's not been a good hell? Okay? Yeah. Yeah. Well, here's what I want to tell you today. God has a plan, and God's going to do something in this house. We're going to end this year on a high note. You're going to end this year thinking that you can conquer the world, because you can. You can. And I want to talk to you today on the subject of hindered but not defeated. So here's the text. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 17 and 18, it says, "But we, brothers, being taken from you for a short time in presence, not in heart, endeavored all the more abundantly to see your face with great desire. Therefore, we wish to come to you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us." Satan hindered us. Now, I want to start by telling you that Satan has parameters. So many people today believe that the enemy of our soul, Satan, the devil, Lucifer, whatever you want to call him, that he has carte blanche. That he's the prince of this world and all this kind of stuff. Look, you understand that he may be a prince of this world, but the prince is subordinate to the king, right? And the king that we serve is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's Jesus Christ. Now, here's what I want you to do with me this morning, okay? I need you to help me. I promise you, I will give everything I've got if you'll give everything you've got back. All right? Because I literally need to clean out the pipes this morning. I've been teaching on Sunday morning since May. Today, we're going to go for a ride. We're going to go for a ride. All right, so here it is. Here it is. Satan's authority parameters. The Bible says that the thief comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. I want you to understand something. He comes to do that. He doesn't have the authority to do it. That's his purpose for existence. He wants to be able to do that. He wants to come and he wants to steal your joy. He wants to come and he wants to destroy your life. He wants to thwart the plans of God in your life. But I want you to understand something today, that he may come that way, but he doesn't have the authority to do that. The only authority that Satan has is this: he can hinder you. Oh, but I've been defeated so many times. But Satan doesn't have that authority. As a Christian, as a child of God, Satan does not have the authority to defeat you. I don't care what's going on in your life. I don't care what hell is thrown at you. I don't care what life is thrown at you. I don't care how many bad decisions that you've made. Satan does not have the authority to defeat you. And you need to get that into your head this morning, and we need to recognize this reality. What about those who are living in defeat? Listen to me. Satan did not defeat them. He hindered them. He maneuvered them into a place or into a situation, and they quit. They surrendered. They forfeited. They gave up. Oh, but Phil, I'm just defeated. Listen, if you are this morning, it's not because Satan did it. Satan does not have that authority. You defeated yourself. You threw in the towel. You gave up. You said it's over. You said, I can't make it. Now listen. When you and I do that, Satan gets the win. He gets the win. I played ball for a really long time, and the worst outing that I could ever have as an athlete was to show up to a game and the other team didn't show. Now, at the end of the year, you still get the W, but there's no gratification in that, except for Satan. He'll take the W any way he can get it. Because here's the truth. He knows the only way he can get the win is if we forfeit. Because he doesn't have the authority to defeat us. No matter what he tries to do, no matter what he throws at you, no matter what people think he has, and no matter what he thinks in his head that he has, I want you to understand, he may have been something in heaven at one time, but God got a belly full of it, and he's no longer there. And he's going to and fro on this earth, the Bible says, like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Seeking whom he may devour. Doesn't say he will devour. The only way you become a hot lunch to the enemy is if you quit. That's it, plain and simple. All right, let's move on. The devil can hinder, but he cannot defeat. Say this, I'm hindered.
I'm not defeated.
Okay, you ready for the ride? Here is your Emancipation Proclamation. Upon this rock, Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That's the proclamation today. Four weapons, here they are. Four weapons that Satan will use to get you to a place that you give up. The first thing he uses is accusation. He's the accuser of the brethren. He's going to come and he's going to tell you what he thinks you are. The problem we have is that we believe his voice. We believe his voice. We believe maybe it's said through other human beings and we take it as fact. Maybe it's someone that we love, someone that we really felt close to, and they said something bad about us or said something harsh to us or negative about us, and we gravitated to that thing and we held it and we've cherished that thought, that we've cherished that accusation. Satan will use accusation against you. The second thing is deception. He will try to deceive us. Deceive us with things that pull us away from God, deceiving doctrine, deceiving spirits, deceiving processes of thought, where we get our thoughts all jumbled up and all mixed up and we think something other than what the Word of God says about us. The third one is distraction. We were singing about that just a few minutes ago. Distraction. How many times do we come in here on Sunday mornings and instead of engaging in worship, we're thinking about the past week or the past morning? How many times do you get up on Sunday morning and you're planning on coming to church and having a great worship experience and all hell breaks loose at your house? You know how it goes. You wake up in the morning, you and your wife, and your kids, and you get in the car, all the way here, and you get in the parking lot, oh, praise Jesus. You know, you put on the mask. Look, here's the thing this morning. Take the mask off, because here's the reality. Satan can only hinder you. He can't defeat you. But he'll try. He'll try to distract you with everything under the sun. Worship team in here this morning had AVMs going bad. Things were acting up. But did it stop the worship team from bringing us into God's presence? No, because they pushed through the distractions. Pushed through that stuff. But that's to understand, that's one of the things that he uses to bring us to a place of discouragement, which is the fourth weapon. The children of Israel were ready to go into the promised land. They sent spies in to spy out the land. They came back. Eight of them said, we can't do this. We can't go in. We can't go in. Joshua and Caleb, we can do this. God said it's ours. We can do this. And this is kind of my deal this morning. I'm telling you, you can do this. But the other side, they're telling you can't. Other people are telling you can't. The enemy's whispering in your ear, you can't do this. And the problem with that is the Bible says that they literally complained all night long because of their discouragement. They watch God miraculously move them out of Egypt. They get to the edge of the promised land, and instead of going in and possessing the land, they were discouraged because of the negative report, and they never got 40, those people under 40 years of age, over a million people, never entered into the promised land. They died in the wilderness because they were discouraged. So the enemy will use accusation. He will use deception. He will use distraction, and he will use discouragement. ADDD. Yeah. Instead of ADHD, ADDD. All right? He'll use that. What I want you to get this morning is this. God has an eternal purpose in mind for every single solitary person in this room, and every single solitary person on this planet. God has an eternal purpose. Now, sometimes we look at people's lives. Sometimes we look at our own lives, and they seemingly living in defeat. And we look at them and go, well, they just got defeated. But the truth is, if you were to look at the season that they're in, or if you look at the season that you're in right now, you may feel like you've been defeated. But God has an eternal purpose that is far greater than the season of perceived defeat that you're in right now. Look, we get so stuck in the moment. It's kind of like you can't see the forest for the trees. We're stuck in this soccer. We're stuck in this situation. And everywhere we turn, we're getting knocked down and getting knocked around and beat up and all this kind of stuff. And the truth of the matter is, we begin to embrace that negativity. We begin to embrace that negative report when the enemy accuses us and said, you're not who you think you are. You're nothing but just a piece of trash. We begin to believe that stuff. And then we begin to have these thoughts in our mind. He deceives us in our mind, and we begin to hold fast to those things that the enemy's speaking to us. Deceptive thoughts. Then we get distracted because all we're looking for is the next shoe to fall. The next thing to hit us from some unknown place. And over time, we get discouraged. When we get to that point of discouragement, if we're not in tune with the eternal purpose of God, we'll quit. We'll quit. Remember, you can be hindered, but you cannot be defeated if you will not give up. So let's take a look at Scripture today. I'm going to look from Genesis through most of the Bible in like 10 minutes. Look, I had 3 cups of iced coffee this morning. Woo! Mm-hmm. I got up real early, and I should not have had all that coffee. My wife is over here. She's going to, you know, if I get to going too fast, she's going to slow me down. When we look at Scripture, though, we see the plan and purpose of God has been hindered on many occasions. Been hindered on many occasions, but has never, ever, ever been defeated. All the way back in the beginning, God set man and woman in the garden. Adam and Eve were in the garden. He set them there in a place of perfection. He had fellowship with them, had communion with them, like we've never known up to the point that Jesus comes on the scene. There was a separation when Adam and Eve fell. But before God pronounced the curse on Adam and Eve because of their sin, he first cursed the serpent. And in the middle of that curse of the serpent, he gave a blessing to humanity. And that was it. The blessing was this. He's speaking to Satan, and he said, her seed, you're going to bruise his heel, but her seed is going to crush your head. It's going to crush your head. Now, God spoke his curse over Adam and Eve, and they had to leave the garden and all that kind of stuff. But he gave Adam and Eve the first glimpse of what was to come, and that was Jesus Christ coming on the scene. The seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. In other words, before God gave a curse over Adam and Eve, he spoke a blessing to them. The Bible says then, God said to Adam and Eve, he said, it's going to get bad, but I want you to understand that help's on the way. Help's on the way. So then Satan began to do his deal. By the time we get to Genesis 6, the entire world is corrupt. Genesis 6 said that the sons of God had relations with the daughters of men and all this kind of stuff. And kind of like Satan just simply said, well, here's the deal. If the person that's going to defeat me is going to come through human seed, then I've got to corrupt humanity to a point that God will just wipe them off from the face of the earth. Well, you read a little bit further on, and what we find is this, that the world got so corrupt that God sent a flood. He sent a flood, and he destroyed all of humanity except one man and his family. That was Noah. Satan's going, I've got corruptness on the earth. There's wickedness everywhere. I have thwarted the plan of God. I've stopped the plan of God. I've defeated the plan of God. But somebody built a boat. Somebody built a boat. There was 8 souls on the boat. The Bible said they were saved by the wood, the water, and the wind. They built an ark out of gopher wood. That's what they got into. They stayed in the ark. The water is that raised them up above the earth where all the death was. And the wind is what blew them to Mount Ararat and eventually blew all the water from this earth. Now that's symbolic of the way we get saved. We're saved by the wood, which is the cross of Jesus Christ. We're saved by the water, which represents the washing of the word into our lives when we get into his book. And then we're saved by the wind, which happened in the upper room when there came a rushing mighty wind from God. Listen to me. You and I can make it if we've got the cross, if we've got the word, and if we've got the wind. We can make it. Say this with me. I'm hindered. Come on, say it. I'm hindered, but I'm not defeated. I'm not defeated. You believe that yet? Okay, that's about a fifth of you. Still got 10 minutes or so. I'll get the rest of you before it's over with. Satan never stops. He never stops trying. Noah gets off the boat, and as soon as he's off the boat, he gets drunk. And not only did he get drunk, he had sex with his kids, with his daughters. Sickening. Once again, God has saved the plan through Noah and his family, and now Noah has stepped off the reservation, if you will. Is God's plan defeated? No. It's just hindered because God goes over to Terah's house. And he says, you know what, there's a guy over there by the name of Abram. And Abram is going to be the father of many nations. But it's going to be one particular nation, and out of that nation there's going to be 12 tribes. And out of that 12 tribe, there's going to be one tribe called Judah. And it's out of the tribe of Judah that the person that is going to bruise or that's going to crush the head of the serpent is going to come through him. So Israel is born. The 12 tribes of Israel. But then they wind up in Egypt for 400 years. Is God's plan hindered or is it defeated? It's just hindered. But it is hindered. It is hindered. For 400 years, they're in Egyptian captivity. The enemy says, I've stopped it. It's been defeated. And then we get down to 2 Kings chapter 11, and there was a woman by the name of Athaliah. She was the granddaughter of Jezebel. The granddaughter of Jezebel. Jezebel was a mean, mean, ornery woman. I mean, that woman would kill you. And she did kill people. She did kill people. She was mean. This is her granddaughter. Her granddaughter, the granddaughter of Jezebel, Athaliah, she decides she wants to be queen. So she has all of the royal family killed. Supposedly killing all of the royal lineage of the tribe of Judah. Now, if you kill all the tribe of Judah, how is the Messiah going to come through the tribe of Judah? God's plan defeated? No. Because there's a lady by the name of Josheba who takes a little boy named Joash and hides him in the temple, in a bedroom closet in the temple, for 6 years. Athaliah thought she had wiped out Judah from the face of the earth, that she was going to be the queen. But this lady takes Joash and puts him in a closet in the temple. In the temple. She's sitting on the throne, thinks she's got everything going like it's supposed to be going. Now, here's the thing. This goes on for 6 years. Now, you know, as Americans, we like what we like, and we like it quickly. That's why we like our fast food. That's why we like microwaves. That's why we like stuff that we can cook in 5 minutes or less, because we want to get it and get it done. We don't like to wait for anything. We don't even like to shop anymore. We want to get online and have it delivered to us. We want what we want. We want it quickly. How many times do we get impatient with God's grace in our life? I mean, years are going by. Athaliah is on the throne. She's the queen. She's on the throne. Satan's going, I've taken care of this. I have thwarted God's plan. I've destroyed God's plan. I've defeated God's plan. But then, after 6 years, out of the closet, God brings a little boy king named Joash. You say, what's that? What's the point? Here's the thing. God brought victory out of the closet in 2 Kings. What does that mean for you and I? It means this. God brings victory out of unusual places. Places that you and I would never, ever, ever think victory could come from. And then there it is. Some of you are in this room this morning and you're sitting here thinking, I'm just feeling a square today. I just come to church because it's Sunday and I'm supposed to do this, but I'm really not into this and I'm really not here. But I'm telling you, before you leave here today, God's going to show you some victory that you haven't seen in a really long time. And you're going to feel differently when you leave this place than you did when you came in here. Did you hear what I said? God's going to do something in your life here this morning. If you'll just hang in there and you won't quit, God's going to change something in you. He's going to bring victory out of the most unusual places. But you got to be ready for it. You got to be ready for it. Let's face it. The last place you want somebody looking in your house is in your bedroom closet. I mean, you think about it. I mean, there may be a neat freak or two around here that it wouldn't be a big deal, but for most of us, uh-uh. You're not getting into the closet. You're not even getting in the bedroom. And sometimes you're not even getting in the house. You know what I mean? But here's the thing. The enemy's sitting on the sidelines. He's going, I have defeated the plan of God because the tribe of Judah is eradicated. But God had a plan. Joash is hidden for 6 years. 6 years later, God begins to do something. God begins to bring about his plan. The enemy has done nothing but hinder it. He hasn't defeated anything. Do you know how the people overcame Queen Athaliah? In 2 Kings 11, verse 10, they went to the temple. There's a museum in the temple that had all the artifacts of Israel in there. And in the artifacts, the Bible says that David, King David's weapons were on the wall. His spear, his shield, the sword he had used to cut Goliath's head off, all of those things, they were on the wall. And the Bible says that the priests went in there and they took the old ancient warfare instruments off the wall and they went to where the queen was and they said, we've about had all this we're going to have. They took those old ancient weapons out of the closet and they set it up on the thing. They took Athaliah off the throne and Joash was anointed king, the tribe of Judah, still existing. Now remember, back in the book of Genesis, the one Satan said, he's not, no human being is going to crush my head. I'm going to make sure that the plan of God is defeated. But what are we seeing? That the plan of God has been nothing but hindered. It has never been defeated. It's never been defeated. Are you getting what I'm saying to you this morning? All right. Don't leave me. Stay with me, okay? They took victory out of the closet and set it on the throne. You and I have some ancient weapons this morning. You and I have some ancient weapons. The enemy has accusation. The enemy has deception. The enemy has distraction. The enemy has discouragement. But you and I have some ancient weapons that are at our disposal. They work for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. They work for Daniel in the lion's den. They work for David facing Goliath. The weapons that you and I have on our hand are the name of Jesus Christ. There is no name given under heaven where men can be saved. We have the name of Jesus. We have the Word of God. We have the power of the Holy Spirit, and we have the promises of the Lord. But ultimately, the most powerful weapon that you and I have is the blood of Jesus Christ that washes away every stain of sin in our life. That's what the weapons that you and I have. All Satan can do is hinder you. He cannot defeat you. Paul said this. He said, I've been cast down, but I haven't been defeated. J.B. Phillips says this. The Phillips translation says this. I've been knocked down, but knocked out. I've been knocked down, but I have not been knocked out. When I was a teenager, which is a long time ago now, we had in our neighborhood, we had a little boxing league. Had a little boxing league. And there was 12, 14 of us guys in our neighborhood there where I lived. And we would, every weekend we'd get out there and we had boxing gloves. We got out and we had fights. We fought. And then what you learn when you start boxing, it's the same way with football too. When you want to get hit, you want to get hit hard and you want to get hit early. Because once you've been hit really hard, you know, then you can move through it. You're not scared of getting hit anymore. You get popped really hard right off the bat, and if you're still standing, you know you got a chance. All right? I mean, so you get popped. Listen to me. Some of you have been popped. Some of you have been knocked down. But here's the deal. It's up to you whether or not you get up or not. Look, getting hit hard and getting hit often like that is a part of living our life in this earth. It's a part of being a Christian. But if you want to get up and you want to move forward, I promise you that the next blow you'll be able to take even stronger. You won't be able to, he will not defeat you. You can be knocked down, but you'll never be knocked out if you're a child of God. That's what the Word says. You've been cast down, but you're not destroyed. Say this, I'm hindered, but I'm not destroyed. Satan hears these angels in Bethlehem. The king's coming. So what does Satan do? He ensures that the Roman Empire is the most corrupt nation the world had ever known up to that point. Because in the back of his mind, he's just going, look, no way God's going to send a king, the Messiah, into these palaces all over this place. Not going to send him in there. So the corruption throughout the Roman Empire was vast. But God had no intention of sending Jesus to a palace. Instead, he chose a stable. He chose a cave or a barn in Bethlehem. And out of that barn, everybody's looking for the palace. Everybody's looking for the conqueror on the white horse. Everybody's looking for a military leader. No one's looking for a baby with the cows and chickens. Nobody's looking for that. So what did the enemy try to do? He tried to stop it again. But he can't do anything but hinder. He can't defeat the plan of God and the purpose of God. Sometimes we get through and get into our situations in our life We don't look too good. Sometimes we go through our life and we're not on top of it all, but the truth is, and I want to speak this into somebody's life here this morning, you maybe feel like you're less. You may have listened to the accusations of the enemy. You may have had the distractions of the enemy in your life. You may even be in a point of discouragement and almost to the point of giving up this morning. But here's, I want to speak this into your life today. I want you to understand the truth is that you're headed for a throne. You're headed for a throne. God knows how to raise you from the barn to the throne, from the cave to the throne, from the stable to the throne, from your situation to the throne. God will do that. That is his eternal purpose. Do you not understand this morning that you and I, as children of God, we are kings and priests unto God. We're heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. We're going to rule and reign with God, with Jesus on high. We're going to do those kind of things. That's the eternal purpose of God. Don't quit. Say, I'm hindered, but I'm not defeated. All right, watch this now. The baby's born. Satan has messed up. He didn't do what he thought he had a plan, so he would corrupt the palaces. But the baby's born anyway. So what does he do? Well, he's got to kill all the babies. So he moves in Herod's heart to destroy, through jealousy, to destroy all of the male children 2 years of age and under. Kill them all. Now, why 2 years? Why 2 years? Well, here's the thing about 2 years. There's something about that mark, that 2 year, 24 month time period, that if you can maintain a certain level of intensity with God, a certain level of commitment in your marriage, a certain level of commitment in your area of work, a certain level of clarity when it comes to your addictions and being clean of those things, there's something about that 2 year mark that something happens in the spirit realm. It's why psychologists and psychiatrists will tell you this, that after you've been divorced, that you should wait for 2 years before you reengage in another relationship. Because all that past stuff, all that baggage, all that other stuff, you got to let that stuff go. You got to clean out all that stuff. There's something about that 2 year mark that God comes on the scene and a spiritual principle becomes engaged in there. And the word says that the angels will even begin to bear you up. That spiritual pattern, there's a hump that we get over in there. Here's the deal. After 2 years, you can't kill it. If you stay on fire for God for 2 years, guess what? That ain't going to die. That ain't going to die unless you kill it. That ain't going to die unless you give up on it. Some of you this morning, you're in this place today, and you've been fighting a certain battle. You've been fighting it for 2 years, and you're holding on. You're doing everything that you know to do, and you're getting closer to that 2 year mark. All I got to tell you is this. Just hang on a little bit longer. Herod wanted to kill every child, every male child 2 years under. Satan wanted to destroy the seed that was going to crush his head. Hang in there. Hang on. The devil cannot kill what will not die. Amen? Are you hanging with me this morning? You may be hindered, but you're not defeated. Let's get back to the story. Jesus begins his earthly ministry. The devil's upset, as you can imagine. Heaven says this. Heaven speaks these words. He comes out, he's baptized, heaven's open. Here's the word. This is my son in whom I am well pleased. Hell hears that word. Hell hears the word. Remember one of the weapons, accusation. Hell always fights you over what heaven says about you. Hell always fights you over what heaven says about you. Some of you have been listening to the voice of hell. And you've listened to it for so long that it is overridden in your mind and in your heart what heaven has always spoken over you. That this is my child. That you're fearfully and you're wonderfully made. That he has a plan and a purpose for your life. That the enemy's hindered you, but he can't defeat you if you'll stay the course. You're not a piece of trash. You're not a useless individual. You have giftings. You have the mind of God. You have the spirit of God. You have the life of God. You have the breath of God in you, and you're created in the image of God. That's what heaven says about you. And I have a plan. He says, I have a plan for your life to bring hope and a future and not harm, to bring success and not failure, for you to be the head and not the tail. That's what heaven says about you. But hell's always going to argue with us about that. He's always going to tell us that you're never going to measure up. You're never going to be, you've done too many bad things. You've got too much stuff in your closet. There's too many things in your past. There's too many things going on in your present. You're never going to measure up. And I'm here to tell you today that you and I don't have to measure up, because Jesus has already measured up for all of us. Can I get a witness in the house this morning? Jesus is the standard. You're not. I'm not. Jesus is the standard. He's already measured up for all of us. And hell is upset. Hell is upset. Jesus goes into the wilderness. Here comes the devil. I will give him this. He is persistent. He says, if you're the Son of God, jump off this wall. The angels will bear you up. Throw yourself down from here. Blah, blah, blah. All these things. What is he trying to do? Well, he's trying to do the same thing that he's been trying to do since Eden. He was trying to get Jesus to die in some other way other than the cross. If Jesus had jumped off the pinnacle of the temple to prove his deity, he would have defeated the plan of God. And the sacrifice would have not been for you and I. But he didn't do that. He said to Satan, it is written. Three times, it is written, it is written. Satan's trying to get him to die some other way instead of getting to the cross. He said, get behind me, Satan. Jesus comes out of the wilderness. He heals the sick. He casts out devils. He shakes the gates of hell off its hinges for 3.5 years. He goes to the cross. He goes to the cross. And Satan knows that he is in some kind of serious trouble. He's hanging on the cross. Satan remembers this prophecy from King David 100 years before, that none of the Messiah's bones will be broken. None of the Messiah's bones will be broken. Now, Roman law decreed this. People that were crucified, at some point their legs had to be broken so that death would come quickly after that. So one of the soldiers, the enemy's whispering to the soldier, go to the break, go break his legs. The order came, go break all their legs, all three of them. And what's the deal with that? For Jesus to be the perfect, spotless, sinless lamb, not one of his bones could be broken. If the Roman soldier could break his bones, his legs, then it would just literally invalidate the sacrifice completely. It would just render it null and void. They break the first thief, they break the other thief, they go to Jesus and they go, oh, well, he's already dead. Now what's happened? Was the plan of God defeated? No, it was just hindered. It was just hindered. If he was marred, if he was lame, it would be an unacceptable sacrifice, and then you and I would have no hope this morning. But when they got there, the word of God had already overridden Roman law. Jesus was already dead. There was no need to break his legs. Here's what the Lord wants somebody in this house to know this morning. Sometimes situations, and I wrote this down, sometimes situations come into our lives and an enemy will whisper, this is going to break you. This is going to break you. This is going to destroy you. But there is a word that was already spoken hundreds, even thousands of years before that says, it can't break you and it can't destroy you. You can be hindered, but you cannot be defeated. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. It doesn't say there's not going to be weapons formed. It just says that none that are formed against you are going to prosper. In other words, they're never going to be able to overtake you. There is no demon in hell. Satan does not have the authority. He does not have the power. No demon in hell has been authorized to defeat you. All they can do is hinder you. That's all they can do. That's it. Jesus dies. The devil heard him say, it's finished. David also said this about the Messiah, that he would not let his body suffer decay or corruption. Corruption begins to set in. Decay begins to set in about day 3. Late hours of the 3rd day or the 4th day, that's when it begins to set in. Late hours of the 3rd day, into the fourth day. So what's Satan's plan? All we got to do is keep him in the tomb. All we got to do, get past the third day, get into the fourth day, decay is going to set in, corruption is going to set in, and he can't be the Messiah. First day. Can you see this in your mind? For the end of the first day, Satan's got parties building in hell. Party's building. They're throwing a party. We got him. He's in the tomb. He's off the cross. He's in the tomb. It's sealed. There's a big rock there. There's soldiers out there. They're guarding it. He's in the tomb. That's day one. We got through. Okay, day two. Day two. The party's beginning to build even bigger. They're more excited now. This is the second day. They get through the second day. They get into the third day. All we got to do is get through this next 24 hours, and corruption is going to set in, and he won't be the Messiah, and the plan of God will be defeated. The problem is the third day. The problem is the third day. That sometime during that day, all of a sudden there's this earthquake. The stone rolls away. Angels come down. The soldiers pass out from fright. They just fall down as dead men. All of a sudden, Jesus steps out. He goes up to Satan. Now, you say, well, you're taking some liberty. Just a little bit. But here's the thing. He goes up to Satan, and he says this to Satan. He says, Satan, you don't even have the keys to your own house. You don't even have the keys to hell. I've got the keys to hell, to death, and the grave. You don't even have the keys to your own house. This house is my house. I am the authority. I am the king. You may be the prince of the power of the air, but I'm the King of kings, and I'm the Lord of lords. That's who we serve. That's who we serve. Ooh, this feels good this morning. And I've lost my place in my notes. Say, I'm hindered, but I'm not defeated. Charlie, team, y'all, come on. Listen to me. The blood of the Lamb of the tribe of Judah, has made you and I more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. We can be hindered. We can have accusations leveled at us. We can have even the attempts of being deceived. We can be distracted and even find our places in times of discouragement. But the only way that Satan gets the win is if we quit.